kind of chilly Sunday morning. We just thought it was spring, didn't we? Yeah, that was Mother Nature pulling one on us. That was not spring yet. Here we go. Yeah, it's still winter. Spring is on the calendar, but it's not here yet. We're so glad to see you this morning in the house of the Lord. This is a week of spring break. We know we got a lot of families that are out and they're doing stuff, and that is great. But it looks like we got a lot of kids over here, though. That's good. If you're a kid, raise your hand. Okay, yeah, I see those hands. Yeah, we got, yeah, I don't believe that. But we want to invite you to join us in our worship this morning. We're just going to lift up the name of Jesus. You can't go wrong, can you, when you do that? If you're going to worship together as God's people in his house, you can't ever miss by just lifting up and praising and blessing the name of Jesus. And so that's what we want to do this morning. And our opening song tells us to bless his holy name. So let's stand up and let's join together in singing. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name.
Matthew chapter 5 and verse 10 says, "Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for the kingdom of heaven is theirs. You are blessed when they insult you and persecute you and falsely say every kind of evil against you because of me. Be glad and rejoice because your reward is great in heaven, for that is how they persecute the prophets who were before you." Good morning. Nobody's told you today. I love you. I'm super thankful for you. You guys make everything better. It's just another good day, another good Sunday to come up here, be able to worship with you, glorify God with you, fellowship with you, just to be able to see some of you that are smiling, some of us that are still not awake. I am a part of that crowd, and because we lost an hour, which in turn makes it feel like we lost 10. And it was not a good morning, and I'm not a morning person. First thing that I got this morning, instead of a wonderful good morning message from my lovely fiance, was I need a nap. So, if anyone else needs a nap, let's worship God, and then we'll all go take a nap.
Amen.
But I'm serious. I do love you. I do love every one of you. I'm super thankful for you. If you were able to be here and serve yesterday for the Hart family, thank you for everything that you've done. Thank you for the service that you did. The food that you brought, thank you for that. That was awesome. You guys show up and show out every single time. And the Lord always blesses through every one of you, and it is amazing to see what God does in all of your lives. Just real quick, Wednesday night service is not, I think it's right, we're not having Wednesday night service this week because it's spring break. Doesn't feel like spring break outside, but we won't have anything like that. But I will tell you this, Wednesday night we are having, in the youth, we are having a study over the, if you watch the Super Bowl, we're going over the He Gets Us campaign, and we are looking into it and seeing what Scripture says about the things that they believe in their agenda. And so it was fantastic last week. It's going to be fantastic next week. So if you know anybody that would like to come and hear that and want to be a part of the youth group, so please bring them, invite them. We'd love to have them. Also, if you really want to come and you want to, you know, spend the whole time dodging basketballs, kickballs, dodgeballs, pool noodles in the gym from kids, listening to them sound like they have a tap dancing class upstairs, come on Wednesday night and see when we are in a packed house with a bunch of screaming kids. It is fantastic. It's totally worth it. But you see where God is working and how He's working. So that, with that being said, please be in prayer for our Wednesday night, but most importantly, also be in prayer for our Sunday mornings, for growth, spiritual, physical, so that we can start growing together as a family, growing together as a church, so that we can, in turn, I'm not doing that. Way to go. So that we can be able to get the Word of God out to the community more, because in case you haven't noticed, the community of Holly Springs is struggling. There are families in our church that are struggling, and what better way to minister to them than through our own family in our church? So I'm going to pray for us. Brother Bob is going to continue to lead the music, and then he's going to introduce our speaker this morning. So let's open our hearts, let's open our souls, let's be able to worship God. And Mark, the Bible says, Jesus says, that the greatest commandment is to worship the Lord your God and to love the Lord your God with all your heart, your soul, your strength, and your mind. And the second is to love your neighbor as yourself. And that is for today, as any other day, we are to worship the Lord, we are to love the Lord. And in turn, it helps us love each other. So I'm going to pray for us, and that's what we're going to do. We're going to worship and glorify our living God. So let us pray. Most kind and gracious Heavenly Father, Lord God, we come to you now, Lord, opening our hearts up to you, God, opening our souls up to worship to you, Lord, to praise your name, to glorify your name, God, to praise the name of Jesus, to glorify his name, God, the man who come and died for us. He lived a perfect life and died on that cross. He freely gave up his life. He freely laid down on that cross. He took every whip, he took every nail, he took everything, every beating he took for us, God. And we thank you, Lord, that he was so willing to do that so that if we accept him, we can know you, we can have a relationship with you. Lord, as we sit here and we stand here and we worship and we praise you, God, I pray that you would just enter into this place, God, enter into this sanctuary of worship. God, allow us to feel your presence. Allow us to grow spiritually close to you. God, allow us just to worship you. Lord, we thank you for Jesus. God, I pray now for anyone in here who is struggling with something, who is going through something, God, that you would just place your hand over them. God, allow them to feel you. Allow them to feel your love. It's in Jesus' name that I pray. Amen.
Thank you, Eli.
And we love you too, by the way. God bless you. And before we sing, I will go ahead and introduce our speaker. Because really he needs, as they say, no introduction. He's been here several times to preach in the absence of our pastor, who, by the way, is out visiting with one of his daughters and grandchildren. And he texted me, in fact, this morning and said to tell the church that he's praying for our service this morning, praying for Brother Phil and hope that we have a great worship time together this morning. And I told him I would pass his greetings on to you. So I have fulfilled my mission this morning. Second mission is to introduce our speaker, which I said we don't really need to, unless you're just new or you're watching by, on Facebook or something. You might not have seen or heard Brother Phil Glisson before, but it's always a delight to hear him preach. I say delight, but he preaches strong. He preaches strong the Word of God, and he has been an evangelist since he was a teenager. In fact, he was talking to Larry about being on a youth trip. Youth retreat,
yep. And
1974, and wow. Preaching as a youth evangelist. So he's been at this a long time, and just let me say, he's getting good. He's getting pretty good at it. And we were talking about the Jesus Revolution movie, and about how that kind of coincides with when we both began our ministries. And of course, I've retired. I'm much older than Phil, but. I've already been retired once, maybe twice. I think I've been retired twice, and here I am again. But Suzanne and I actually started in evangelism after graduating from Union, where also Phil graduated from Union University. And so we traveled in full-time evangelism for like 3 years and having revivals almost every week. And seeing churches experience revivals and souls saved and people coming to know the Lord. And, you know, we talk about the Asbury revival. I don't think that's anything compared to what was going on in the early 70s when Phil began preaching as a youth evangelist. And we were traveling in evangelism and seeing the Lord work in revivals throughout the United States. But just to say that that Phil has been anointed in his ministry and he's been faithful to be an evangelist, even though the ranks are are small now. They've dwindled. The churches are not having revivals like they used to as far as scheduled meetings. But I tell you, we need to pray for Phil and other evangelists who are doing the Lord's work, and they're being faithful. Phil has been faithful to preach the word, the truth, the gospel in churches and revivals, and I just want us to pray for him. Okay, and not just for today, not just for today's service, but, you know, when it comes to mind and you think about revival and how we need revival, pray for the revivalist, the evangelist who are helping to preach and lead revivals in churches all over America. And I know you'll do that. But we welcome you, Phil, and we look forward to hearing what God has to say through you. And we're going to continue singing, and you might have noticed that there's a little difference up here on the stage also. And I don't need to point that out, really.
Who? But, tell me, who is it? I want to know.
But we're glad to have Patricia join the praise team today. I thought we would inject a little youth into this thing, okay? And so she has a desire to serve the Lord with her talents, and so we're going to enjoy having her sing with the praise team. And so we welcome her this morning. Okay, you can go ahead and say, hey, welcome, Patricia. We're good today. All right, let's continue to bless the Lord in singing. Stand up. This is our time of worship as we draw near to the Lord. With our voices of praise, bless the Lord, O my soul. Let's worship his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, O my soul, worship his holy name. Sing like never before, O my soul, I'll worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes.
Bless the Lord.
Bless the Lord. His holy name. Sing like never before.
Sing like never before. Oh, my soul, I'll worship your holy name. I'll worship your holy name. Lord, I'll worship your holy name.
Oh, man, that's beautiful. Thank you for all the blessings that you've given to us. We pray now that you would bless us in this hour as we prepare to receive the message. Prepare our hearts. May we do what you call us and lead us to do as we desire to seek to honor and glorify you in this hour. We pray in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Thank you. You may be seated.
Jesus, my Savior, Lord, there is none like you. All of my days, I want to praise the wonders of your mighty love. My comfort, my shelter, tower of rest.
Boy, that was a blessing, wasn't it? I'd like to hear somebody sing with enthusiasm. Well, it's a joy to be back in Holly Springs. I have been here a number of times over the years, and I love you guys and thank God for you and for the encouragement you have been to me. It's good to work with Brother Bob again. We've known each other a long time, and it's just always a blessing to be in the Lord's presence for the Lord's people. I appreciate your pastor and his inviting me to fill in for him today, and I pray that God will use what I help. I pray that God will use what I share to be a help to his church. All right, well, let's turn in our Bibles to the book of Psalms, chapter 9. I want to speak to you on the subject, when all in for the Lord. Psalms 9 is easy to find. If you have a Bible, open it up. You'll get more out of the message. A life insurance salesman visited a lady whose husband had just died. He had sacrificed for many, many years to provide for her a substantial life insurance policy. And when he presented her the check, it was a check for $500,000, he said to her, "Ma'am, this check here is from your husband. You're his beneficiary. He wanted to make sure you were well taken care of upon his death." She wiped her eyes and said, "Nothing can replace that wonderful husband of mine who's left me this $500,000. But she went on to say, "I can tell you this for certain. I would give at least half of it back to have him back." Well, not all of it, would she? She wasn't all in for her husband. Just halfway all in. Well, so many are half-hearted when it comes to the Lord. You know, the heart, according to Hebrew thought, was the center of a person's character and will. In fact, we read in the book of Proverbs where it says, "Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it spring the issues of life." Mary, who anointed Jesus' feet in the New Testament with perfume and wiped those feet with her hair, she was all in, wasn't she? Well, some say they cannot be all in for the Lord. What they mean by that is they will not be all in for the Lord. Now, this doesn't mean when we're all in for the Lord we're perfect, but it but does mean God has us and we want to be all in for Him. You know, the Lord must do something in us before He can do something for us and through us, and certainly before we can be all in for the Lord, we have to have the Lord in us. And that's what salvation is all about, when the Lord comes into us upon our invitation. And then once He's in us, then He can enable us, if we so desire, to be all in for Him. Now, certainly we need to be baptized. If we're going to be all in for the Lord, we need to have a church home. All this works in conjunction with God's people. So let's talk about it this morning, about being all in for the Lord. You know, Henry Drummond once said, "Above all things, do not touch Christianity unless you are willing to seek the kingdom of God first." He said, "I promise you a miserable existence if you seek it second." Do you remember when you used not to have men working signs out on the road? You could tell they were working by what they're doing. Can people tell you're all in for the Lord by watching you? I hope they can. If not, I hope you want them to be able to. Well, here in the Psalm of David, Psalm 9, we see how it teaches us about being all in for the Lord and what it affects when we are all in for the Lord. In other words, you cannot be all in for the Lord without it affecting you. It's going to affect you. Well, what is it going to affect? Look at verse 1 in Psalm 9. "I will praise you, O Lord, with my whole heart. I will show forth all your marvelous works." God had David's heart at this particular time in his life. There were times when God did not have David's heart, but here he does. And so, let's talk about it. When God has our heart, we can be all in for him. Well, first of all, it will affect our mouths. When you're all in for the Lord, it will affect your mouth. Did you notice he says again in the latter part of that verse, I will show forth, I will tell of all your marvelous works. David had seen God give him great victories over enemies and other things, and he wanted to use his mouth to praise God and to tell others. If you'll read the book of Psalms, you'll see that the praise of God was rarely a private matter for the psalmist. Heartfelt gratitude must find utterance. And so therefore, when you're all in for the Lord, you'll want to use your mouth to thank the Lord and to tell others about Him and what He's done for you. It affects your mouth. Now, some people open their mouths when they should not. They say every basketball team could use a player. Let's give him baseball team. Well, it could be for basketball too, but my illustrations here is for a baseball team, a football, any sport. Anyway, the baseball team could use a player who never strikes out, never commits an error, plays every position perfectly. But the problem is, how do you get that guy to put his hot dog and Coke down and come out of the stands and play ball? You know, it's the people in the stands who know all about it, right? Yelling at the players on the field. They say it is difficult to remain silent when you have nothing to say. Some of you will get that about lunchtime. There was a man at the gates of heaven and asking St. Peter to let him in. And Peter said to him, you cannot come in here. You've told too many lies. He said, I'll have a heart, Peter. You were once a fisherman yourself. Well, are you lying to God when you say you're all in and you're not? Are you lying to others? Are you lying to yourself? You know, you can convince yourself you're all right with God when you're not. Did you know that? Yeah, I know people who just think that everything's fine between them and the Lord, and it's not, but they have convinced themselves otherwise. Most people commit the same mistake with God they do with their friends. They do all the talking. Listen, we need to let God do some talking to us through His Word and through Christian friends who are concerned for us if we're not saved or if we're not all in for the Lord as a Christian. We need to let God speak through circumstances or whatever, however method He wants to speak to us to show us whether or not we're all in. Again, being all in for the Lord starts with being saved, receiving Christ as your Lord and Savior, then being baptized and joining the church. And when you do get all in for the Lord, again, it's going to affect your mouth. Well, number two, it's going to affect your emotions. Being all in for the Lord affects your emotions. Look at verse 2. David says, I will be glad and rejoice in you. I will sing praise to your name, O you Most High. Now, when you're all in for the Lord, like David was at this time in his life, you can be glad and rejoice and sing like he did no matter what. Being all in for the Lord affects your emotions for the better, even during tough times. And David had plenty of those, didn't he? You see, the present was as full of God as the past, where he saw great victories and deliverances. In other words, he just didn't live in the past. God was at work in his life in the present, and it affected his emotions. Now, there are many people out there who can mess with your emotions. They say lawyers try to do that with juries. I've never sat on a jury. In fact, somebody defined a jury as this, 12 people chosen to decide who has the better lawyer. You see, the lawyers, that's their primary goal, is to mess with the emotions of the jurors so they'll vote in their favor. Emotionally disturbed people often have trouble finding help. Talking about your emotions, a lot of emotionally disturbed people out there, and they're seeking help and can't seem to find it. You probably have heard about the guy in New York who was all emotionally disturbed and upset and felt like he needed a psychiatrist and wanted to see the best, so he picked a psychiatrist's office on Park Avenue. And when he arrived, he went into the office, and it was a beautifully decorated reception room. But there was nobody there to greet him. But he did see two doors. One said, men, the other said women. Well, he knew he was a man, unlike a lot of folks today. And he walked through that door. And when he walked through that one, he was in another beautifully decorated reception room. And again, nobody was there, but there were two doors, as I said. One over it said introverts. The other said extroverts. Well, he was an introvert, so he walked through that door. Once again, he's in another beautifully decorated reception room. Nobody there, but again, two doors. One door said for those making less than $100,000 a year. The other door said for those making over $100,000 a year. Well, he made less, so he walked through the door that said for those making less than $100,000 a year. And when he walked through that door, he found himself back out on the street. That psychiatrist didn't want to mess with people like him. Well, you see, that's the way it is. A lot of people, they can't seem to find anybody who will mess with them, you know, who will help them with their emotional disturbances. Well, I have some good news for you. God is there to help us with our emotional disturbances, and His people are there. But you get better help for your emotions, seriously, when you decide, I'm going to be all in for the Lord. It just seems to go better for you emotionally. Amen. Well, you know, they say one reason a dog helps you so much when you're emotionally down is he doesn't want to know why. Well, there's somebody who can give us better help than a dog even, and that's God and His people. You know, if you're seeking any joy outside of a personal relationship with Christ and being all in for Him, you're not going to find it. And listen, God does not want us to walk around as emotional wrecks. We're not good advertisements for Christianity when we're like that. Many today worry about becoming religious fanatics. Well, there's no danger in that for a lot of them who are, if they're worrying about it, you know. Maybe you're saying, well, if I get to be all in for the Lord, are people going to think I'm a religious fanatic? No, they're going to think you're somebody who takes seriously your Christian faith. And you will impress them. And they might decide to check it out for themselves. You know, talking about the Jesus movement and the Jesus Revolution movie and all that, one of the things that I remember about that time, and many of you experienced that, people just got all in for the Lord, didn't they? That's just one of the ways you can put it. Well, you know, the devil would much rather put a long face on a Christian than to burn down the biggest church in town. Did you know that? Maybe if you're long-faced, you need to get all in for the Lord yourself. Because, it will affect your emotions for the better than anything else you can do. You know, a lot of these people today who have a long face, they're spending a lot of money trying to decorate their face. They just need to get all in for the Lord and get their emotions in better shape. And that will do more for their face than all this other stuff they're buying to help their face. Amen. And then number three, it affects your outlook, your mouth, your emotions. Being all in for the Lord affects your outlook, how you see things as you look out. Verses 3 and following. When my enemies are turned back, they shall fall and perish at your presence. For you have maintained my right in my cause. You sat in the throne judging right. You have rebuked the heathen. You have destroyed the wicked. You have put out their name forever and ever. Oh, you enemy destructions are come to a perpetual end, and you have destroyed cities. Their memorial has perished with them. Now, David was all in for the Lord here, and notice the effect that it had on his outlook. He saw that God was still on his throne, and God was going to rightly judge and rebuke the people who were trying to hurt David, and he was going to destroy evil, and he was going to bring for David justice. He was going to fight for him. In other words, when David got all in for the Lord, he, as he looked out over his enemies who were trying to do him in, he saw that God was going to be able to bust their britches, and he didn't have to get down to their level and operate like they did. It affected his outlook. You see, when you're all in for the Lord, it affects your outlook. It affects the way you see things. You know, we're supposed to be seeing things different as Christians. We're not supposed to have the same eyesight that non-Christians have and be so bothered by what we see out there. We're supposed to be able to see things in a different light through the eyes of Christ. And when you're all in for the Lord, it helps you see that better. There's a story about a man who was in prison for robbery, and his wife wrote him a letter asking him when would be the best time to plant the potatoes. They had a garden, and he wrote back and said, oh, don't plant the potatoes right now. Where we normally do, that's where I've hid all my guns. Well, you know, prison mail is censored, and before long, officers were out there digging in that potato patch looking for those guns. His wife wrote back when they left to her husband complaining, they've dug up the whole potato patch. He wrote back and said, good, now you can plant the potatoes. You see, he saw things differently than most people. He's going to get the men out there from the prison to dig up that potato patch for his wife. Sometimes we are falsely accused. We are misunderstood. We're not appreciated. We just need to get our eyes off people and get them on the Lord. And then once we get the Lord's eyesight in us to see things through his eyes as we look out. Amen. Nobody can overpower the Lord. Listen, if God created the heavens with a word, and he did, he can take care of us with a word if he has to. He can speak when we need him to speak. He can bust britches when we need him to do that. He can handle those things or those people that are trying to do us in, like in David's time, those who were trying to do him in. Did you notice in these verses, David refers to God by saying you six times? The presence of the Lord was sufficient for him. Get all in for the Lord. As one person said many years ago, you will begin to see that Christianity is not a way of looking at certain things. It is a certain way of looking at all things. It is a certain way of looking at all things. In other words, being all in for the Lord affects your outlook. As you look out on all that's going on around you and all the problems and all the turmoil, even in our country today, you see things differently than you used to see them before you were all in for the Lord. And you certainly see things differently from people who are not Christians. Boy, they just don't see like they need to see, do they? And they don't understand God's still on his throne and he's going to have the final word. There's a lady that comes on American Family Radio, you can pick that up here, 88.9 out of Bahia. Anyway, she comes on a Saturday morning, and they replay it on Sunday afternoon. In fact, it's probably on when you go home from, we get out a little early here. I think it's 12 to 1. Anyway, she talks about end-time prophecy and a lot and so forth and tries to do it from a biblical basis. And she says, things are not falling apart, they're coming together. They're coming together. We see the book of Revelation being fulfilled before our very eyes. Well, let's move on. There's a fourth thing. It affects your outlook. Being all in for the Lord affects your mouth. It affects your emotion. It affects your outlook. It affects your outlook. Look, if you will, at verses 7 and 8. But the Lord shall endure forever, for he has prepared his throne for judgment. He shall judge the world in righteousness. He shall minister judgment to the people in uprightness. Notice here, we've already said we're to get our eyes on the Lord, and that's what David did here. But he reassures himself that nobody is going to knock God off his throne, and God is going to righteously judge the world. In other words, He's looking out, but he's also looking back up. And as he looks back up, that inspires him then to look back out again, you see, with the right outlook. And then if he gets a little discouraged, or maybe things are not going like he thinks they ought to, he looks back up and gets his eyes back on the Lord and reassures himself. Nothing catches God by surprise. He is going to take care of what's going on that's bothering David and that's causing problems. You see, we have a God who still knows how to run his world. Now, he doesn't cause sin, but he is going to turn what's going on in this world and turn it around for our good if we'll let him. And he is going to take care of us, because the worst thing that can happen to you in this life is to die, but that turns out the best thing that can happen to you, because you go immediately to heaven if you're a Christian. But friend, you don't lose when you're a Christian. Have you ever thought about that? You don't lose. You're a winner. That's right. But you know, talking about God righteously judging the world, that includes us. He's going to judge us all. That's why you need to be prepared for that judgment day by receiving Jesus Christ as your personal advocate, your personal Lord and Savior. The Bible says in Acts 17:31, this judgment day is coming for all of us. We all have an appointment with it. Talking about the right outlook. Do you remember the California truck driver sitting in his backyard near the Los Angeles airport who would watch the planes come in and wished he could be up there, you know, flying over and seeing things from that perspective? You know, this was back before the days of drones, but he would see the birds and all, and he just wished he could fly. Remember this story? This really happened. I remember when it happened. He got him a lawn chair and got him some water and a couple of sandwiches or whatever, and tied some helium balloons to his lawn chair. And he thought he was just going to, once he cut the balloons, he was going to go up a few hundred feet and just be able to drift over his house and his neighborhood and so forth. But when he cut the helium balloons, he shot up 11,000 feet. You remember, this is a true story. I remember when it happened. Can you imagine that? Almost 2 miles. In fact, the story that I read said there was a plane coming in and a pilot radioed the control tower. There's some guy out here in a lawn chair. And the people at the control tower thought the pilot was drunk. And so, anyway, he did get back down. He began to shoot out. He had a little BB gun. He began to shoot out the balloons one at a time until he got back down. Listen, if that had happened to me, I'd have died on the way up. I mean, I have a fear of heights. I really do. I'd have never made it. But anyway, his desire to fly affected his outlook, didn't it? Friend, you want to fly someday out of this world to heaven? You know, we sing that song, "I'll Fly Away." Get saved, get baptized, join the church, get all in for the Lord. One day we'll all fly, won't we? And we'll go to be with the Lord together, and we'll live with Him in heaven forever. You see, being all in for the Lord affects your outlook. You begin to not only see Jesus in a different light, but as I've said over and over, you begin to see things as He sees them. As you go back and forth between the outlook and the uplook, that's the way you stay all in for the Lord. You, because you don't ever get so weary and discouraged. You just want to quit and just throw in the towel. And you also see that it affects your emotions for the better. And again, it affects your mouth. And you begin to want to talk about what God is doing and how He's blessing and encourage others to get all in for the Lord so they can experience what you are. Well, to sum it all up, a bigger than average man was on some scales in a department store, and the scales were broken. They were out of order. He didn't know it, but there was a little boy standing next to him. He didn't know it before he got on. There was a little boy standing next to him who saw the big man on the scales. And the boy noticed the scales read 75 pounds. And the little boy said to his mother, "Look, Mom, there's a man who is hollow." The little boy knew he ought to weigh more than that. Some people have a faith that is very hollow. They have a faith that is very shallow. Why? They're not all in for the Lord. Are you satisfied with the way things are working for you? You know, an unsatisfied life is often the result of an unsurrendered will. Really, being all in for the Lord is just surrendering afresh and anew to Christ, isn't it, as a Christian? God, I want to surrender to You anew and afresh. I want to be all in for the Lord. I want to be all in for You. You know, as you've heard, Christianity is not just a creed or a set of rules that we memorize. It is a person that we have a relationship with, that we follow, the Lord Jesus Christ. Give your life to Jesus if you haven't done that. Be baptized if you haven't done that. Join this church. You have a wonderful pastor and leadership team here, and good spirit in this church that goes way back. You, Do what God wants you to do. And then say, Lord, I want to be all in for you. I want to be all in for you. I will be all in for you. Again, this doesn't mean you become perfect. I'm not a perfect husband to my wife, but I am all in. You see my point? I am all in when it comes to my wife, though I'm not perfect. You can be all in for the Lord if you want to be. I promise you again, it's going to affect you. It's going to affect your mouth. It's going to affect your emotions. It's going to affect your outlook, and it's going to affect your uplook. Let's bow our heads and close our eyes. Maybe today you just want to come to the altar and get all in for the Lord. You can pray with me, or if you want to, or Eli will be here to receive you. If he is tied up with somebody, I'll pray with you. Maybe today you just want to come to the altar and just talk to the Lord yourself. That's fine. Maybe today you need to join the church. Eli will be here to receive you. Maybe you need an appointment for believer's baptism. You come and share that. Maybe today you need to give your life to Christ. You feel free to do that today. You say, well, I don't know how. Well, we know how to lead you to Christ. We know how to help you with that. We know how to pray with you and give us that privilege. You say, well, I think I'm a Christian, but I'm not sure. Well, let us help you get sure, okay? Let us help you settle it once and for all. Maybe today you are burdened for America and you'd just like to come to the altar and pray for your country. Maybe today you're burdened for some family members and friends who are not all in for the Lord. You want to come down here in the altar and pray for them. That's in order. So as we stand with our heads bowed and our eyes closed and we have the Lord's invitation, let's ask the Lord to move on our hearts and direct us to do what would please Him and what would help us. So as we stand, let's have a word of prayer. Eli will be here, and if he's tied up, I can help you. Father, we thank you so much for this time to have this altar call. Lord, and we know it's a time where you call us to your altar to do business with you or to pray for others. And Lord, I believe in this kind of day in which we live, we need more of your people on your altar praying for this country because we're in desperate shape. We don't have as many people in America all in for you as we did in the past. And we're seeing the results of that. Lord, help every Christian in this room to rededicate themselves to being all in for you. Help those of us who went through that Jesus movement, as the media called it 50 years ago, Lord, the Jesus Revolution. Help us to think back on how things were, and maybe we need to get back some of that kind of commitment we had back then, some of that kind of enthusiasm for the things of God. So, Lord, stir in our hearts this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, as we sing, Eli's here, the Lord's here. I'll be here to help him if we need to. You come.
Jesus is tenderly calling.
Let me say this before Eli comes and dismisses us and has his final word. If you didn't make a response, you'd like to talk to Eli or me or anybody after the service, we're available for you. We're available for you. If you have a burden about your heart, your life, you're not sure you're a Christian, or you have some spiritual need you'd like us to pray with you about, feel free to come up to us. I'll never forget it. I was in a revival meeting in Ohio one time, and it was a younger pastor, and he said, Phil, he said, not many come forward during the public invitation, but he said they do afterwards. And we had several saved that week, several adults, but they all came forward after the invitation was over. But he said if we didn't give the invitation, they wouldn't be coming forward afterwards. Because he said, well, I discovered if you have a message and then just close in prayer and dismiss everybody abruptly, they don't have time to really think about what they've just heard. So he said the invitation is sort of a buffer between the message and the dismissal for it to sort of sink in a little bit. And, you know, I said, that's a good thought. I've never thought about it that way. And so if you're like that, if you didn't come forward but you want to talk, we're available.
Can we give Mr. Phil a hand? He did a fantastic job. Real quick, the one announcement I forgot to mention is summer camp dues are today, $175. Several have already paid for that. If you haven't and you want to, you can contact me or you can contact Luann and let us know. You can also pay online. Is that right? Yeah, you can pay online on the website, on our church website, just $175. And if for some reason you're like, Eli, I want to go, and I don't have $175, talk to me. There's no reason why you can't go to summer camp. That's dead serious, okay? Come talk to me. We'll get you there, okay? I love you. I'm super thankful for you. Brother Bob's going to sing us out. Mr. Phil, if you'll walk back here with me, I encourage everybody to come by, shake his hand, and just talk with him for a second. And I love you. I'm thankful for you. I hope everybody has a good week.
Amen.
Close this.
Last thing, make me a servant. We leave to serve, so we'll see y'all next Sunday. Amen.